Buenos días, mi gente. Bienvenidos a este su programa, La Hora del Cafecito. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to La Hora del Cafecito, un programa dedicado a todos aquellos en nuestra comunidad que están viviendo con el autismo, a todos sus familiares y a todos aquellos que los apoyan. Mi nombre es Lourdes Quiñones. Bienvenidos a la mesa. Adelante, apúntate ahí abajo en los comentarios y déjanos saber si te estás tomando un cafecito con nosotras. Welcome to La Hora del Cafecito, a program dedicated to all those in our community who are living with autism, to all their family members, and to all those who support them. My name is Lourdes Quiñones, and I welcome you to our table, a cafecito table. Please sign in there. Let us know that you're here, and let us know if you're drinking your coffee with us this morning, okay? We'd love to say hello to you. En celebración del mes de la concientización del autismo, queremos traerles todo este mes entrevistas con personas que están cambiando la opinión del público sobre las personas autistas. Y por eso, en el programa de hoy, vamos a estar trayendo a Morenike Giwa Onayiwu y a Keila Rodríguez. Y por eso va a ser el programa en inglés y en español. ¿Okay? Así que ellas son mujeres profesionales, triunfadoras, escritoras y activistas, entre muchos otros títulos, incluyendo el título de autista. Ellas vienen a hablarnos de sus triunfos, de su libro y de cómo su membresía en diferentes grupos minoritarios ha impactado sus experiencias de vida. Así que démosle un cálido recibimiento a nuestro panel de invitadas. Welcome, ladies, to La Hora del Cafecito. Bienvenidas. In celebration of Autism Acceptance Month, we want to feature successful people in our communities who are redefining the public's notion of autism. And for this reason, in today's program, we have the pleasure of interviewing Morenike Giwa Onayiwu and Keila Rodríguez. Both of them are successful professional women, writers, and activists, among other things, and titles. And this includes the title of being autistic. So they come to tell us about their membership in minority groups and how it has impacted their lives. And they're also going to be sharing information about their book and how and to provide hope to our audience. This program is going to be in both English and Spanish, so be sure to stay in with us while we switch to Spanish. Okay, como siempre, vamos a presentarles. I'm sorry, I'm having a little bit of trouble with my eye makeup here. Como siempre, vamos a presentarles a las anfitrionas de este programa. Como ya les dije, mi nombre es Lourdes Quiñones. Soy consultora de las edades primarias aquí en CARD, además de ser fisioterapeuta y maestra de educación especial. Me acompañan mis compañeras, Yasmin Castellano. Buenos días, Yasmin.
Buenos días, Lourdes, y buenos días a todos los que nos están viendo en el día de hoy.
Olivia McDonald. Buenos días, Olivia.
Buenos días.
Maggie Aldana. Buenos días, Maggie.
Buenos días.
Hey, Ima Camposano. Buenos días, Ima.
Buenos días.
Como ya saben, Yasmin Castellano es una excelente profesional en el campo de la salud mental. Es consultora de CARD, asignada al grupo de jóvenes de escuela media hasta jóvenes adultos, y es madre de tres hijos, uno de los cuales está diagnosticada con autismo. Bienvenidas, Yasmin.
Gracias, Lourdes.
Yasmin estará traduciendo al español lo que nuestras invitadas digan. Así que gracias por traducir, Yasmin. Olivia McDonald es consultora de CARD asignada a las edades primarias, así como yo. Es una excelente profesional en el campo de la salud pública y tiene un hermano menor diagnosticado con autismo. Bienvenida, Olivia.
Gracias.
Nuestra compañera Maggie Aldana es una excelente maestra de educación especial. Es la presidenta de la Junta de Padres de CARD. Es madre de tres hijos, dos de los cuales están diagnosticados con autismo. Bienvenida, Maggie.
Gracias.
Ima Camposano está completando una maestría en trabajo social y eligió hacer su internado aquí en CARD, ya que está comprometida a servir a la comunidad de autistas de nuestra comunidad. Ima es madre de dos hijos. Bienvenida, Ima.
Gracias.
So before we get started, I would like to introduce to you to our cafecito hostesses. As I said before, my name is Lourdes Quiñones. I am a CARD consultant assigned to the primary age group. Professionally, I am a pediatric physical therapist as well as a special education teacher. Jasmine Castellano is an excellent professional in the field of mental health. She's a CARD consultant assigned to middle and high school ages, and is the mother of three, one of whom is diagnosed with ASD. Welcome, Jasmine.
Thank you. Thank you, Lourdes.
Jasmine will be translating for our two guests, So thank you, Jasmine, for translating.
My pleasure.
Olivia McDonald is an excellent professional in the field of public health, is a CART consultant assigned to the premier age group, just like me, and has a younger brother diagnosed with ASD. Welcome, Olivia.
Thank you.
Maggie Aldana is an excellent special education teacher, is the chair of CARD's constituency board, and is the mother of three children, two of whom are diagnosed with ASD. Welcome, Maggie.
Thank you, Lourdes.
Emma Camposano is completing her master's in social work and has chosen to do her internship at CARD as she is committed to serving those living with autism in her community. Emma is a mother of two. Welcome, Emma.
Thank you.
Y como siempre, vamos a repasar las reglas por las cuales nos queremos regir durante esta programación. Recuerden que debemos mantener una mente abierta, una actitud positiva y usar un lenguaje respetuoso. Before we get started, let's review the rules by which we want to adhere throughout this programming in order to maintain a safe environment for all of us. We ask that you please keep an open mind, a positive attitude, and use respectful language. Jasmine, ¿por qué no saludas a nuestra audiencia antes de que hagamos la primera pregunta a nuestras invitadas? Would you please say hello to our audience members before we get started with interviewing our guests?
Sí, Lourdes, tenemos a Umi que se encuentra viéndonos en la mañana de hoy. So we have Umi. Thank you, Umi, and welcome, who is watching us today.
Buenos días, Umi, nuestra servidora. Gracias por estar aquí. Okay. Well, I'm going to get started. So thank you again, Morenike and Kayla, for being here. I'm going to start with Morenike. Would you please tell us a little bit about yourself? Buenos días, Morenike. ¿Nos puedes decir un poquito sobre ti?
Oh, she's muted. Morenike, you're muted.
Buenos días a todos. Mi español es muy, muy terrible. So, lo siento. my name is Morenike, and I was born in Minnesota, but my parents are from Nigeria and Cabo Verde. I am autistic, and I have two children who are autistic also. I live with my husband and family in Texas, and I work as a professor and an author, and I enjoy reading and writing.
Oh, thank you. Welcome.
Okay. So mi nombre es Morenike, and excuse me. So I didn't catch, where did you born in?
Minnesota.
Minnesota, okay. So nací en Minnesota, pero mis papás son de Nigeria y Cabo Verde. Tengo dos niños con autismo. También tengo el diagnóstico de autismo. Actualmente vivo en Texas. Soy profesora, autora, y me gusta escribir y leer.
Muy bien. Thank you. So the same question goes to you, Kayla. Can you tell us a little bit about you? ¿Nos puedes decir algo más, algo sobre ti, Kayla?
Hola, me llamo Kayla. I am a Puerto Rican autistic lesbian millennial who is an advocate for herself and other autistic and disabled people. I'm on the advisory board for the Autistic Women and Non-Binary Network, and I co-created the Emery Pecori Young Women on the Autism Spectrum Group in Atlanta. I love video games, archery, movies, especially animation, and rock and indie music. I also write, by the way.
Soy una mujer puertorriqueña, autista, lesbiana, milenaria, que aboga por sus derechos y los derechos de personas con autismo y otras discapacidades. Actualmente pertenezco a la Junta de Mujeres con Autismo y Red No Binario, y soy co-creadora del grupo Emory Pecori de mujeres jóvenes con autismo. Me gustan los juegos de video, tiro al blanco, películas animadas, música de rock, música indie, y también soy escritora.
Muy bien. Thank you, ladies. Welcome for being here. Thank you. Welcome to the show. Thank you for being here. And look at that. This is exactly why we wanted to have you here in the program, to show and highlight the successes and the skills that you have developed, because I think that you're doing a great job of demonstrating what people who are living with autism can achieve. So thank you. Gracias por estar aquí en el programa, por eso mismo queríamos traerlas, porque en este mes estamos celebrando y sacando adelante los triunfos de las personas que están viviendo con el autismo para dejarle saber a todos que sí se puede y que hay esperanza para todos ustedes, padres que están empezando a lo mejor en este camino del autismo, que sepan que, mira, la mente, la frente arriba, ¿eh? So keep that head up, a lot of hope. We're trying to bring parents to maybe starting this journey, in the autism med journey. Keep that head up and knowing that it's all possible. So awesome. Let's continue, Olivia.
Okay. So this is a question for both Morenike and Kayla. Esta es una pregunta para Morenike y Kayla. ¿Cómo comenzaste a abogar por los derechos de personas con autismo y otras discapacidades? How did you get into advocacy?
I always loved volunteering, but mainly I got involved when I was in the university in lots of different organizations. What really sparked things for me was after my children's diagnoses and then mine, it opened my eyes and I began doing a lot of volunteering and working with people with disabilities, and it just grew.
Awesome.
Well, after high school.
Kayla, un momento. Es que Jasmine has to translate for her, so she's just trying to finish her notes, so then I will ask you.
Oh, my bad.
Sorry. It's okay.
That's okay. So, me encantó siempre ser voluntaria, entonces también empecé a estar más envuelta como voluntaria en la universidad. Sin embargo, luego del diagnóstico de mis niños con autismo, me hice voluntaria en diferentes organizaciones y con otras personas también con autismo, y de ahí fue que fue creciendo esa pasión para abogar por las personas con autismo.
Ajá, muy bien. Thank you so much. All righty, Kayla, now, can you tell us how did you get into advocacy?
Sure. Sorry about earlier. After high school, I went to an autism social group where I got connected to an affiliate group of the Autistic Self-Advocacy Network. From there, I went through a few advocacy training programs and I discovered I was good at advocacy and I wanted to help my community.
Awesome.
Al completar la escuela superior, asistí a un grupo social para personas con autismo, en el cual conecté con un grupo afiliado, Red de Autoabogacía para Personas Autistas, o the Autistic Self-Advocacy Network. Participé en varios programas de entrenamiento acerca de la abogacía, en donde me percaté de mi habilidad para abogar y defender mis derechos y los derechos de otras personas, por lo que decidí ayudar a mi comunidad.
I have a question, and I'll say in Spanish first, and then I'll translate into English. ¿Qué has aprendido como defensora de los derechos de personas con autismo? What have you learned from being an autism advocate? And Marinike, can you please go first?
Yes, I've learned that the world is not the way that I believed it was. And I was raised to think that there was a lot of equality and we had come a long way and evolved. I didn't understand how much people still feared and misunderstood disability. So it has taught me to use my voice. It has taught me to be brave. It has taught me to believe in myself and my children. And it has taught me that the impossible is possible.
Awesome. So Jasmine is finishing her notes and she's going to translate for you.
Sí, aprendí que el mundo no es como yo pensé que era. Yo pensé que era con igualdad, un mundo con igualdad, pero desafortunadamente aprendí que hay muchos miedos hacia las discapacidades. Aprendí también a utilizar mi voz, a creer en mí misma, en mis hijos, y que lo que es importante es estar positivo.
Awesome, great. How about you, Kayla? What have you learned about from being an autism advocate?
I have learned many things. I learned that society in general does not listen to the voices of autistic and disability advocates. For example, many autistics do not like Autism Speaks and ABA, yet many neurotypicals, AKA people who aren't autistic, don't listen to autistics and support them anyway, no matter how many times we raise our voices. Another thing I've learned is that disability advocacy spaces are mostly Caucasian. Usually I'm the only non-Caucasian invited to speak on panels, and I wish I saw more non-Caucasian people in these spaces. At least I want more people who look like me and speak Spanish.
He aprendido muchas cosas. Aprendí que la sociedad en general no escucha las voces de las personas que abogan por los derechos de las personas con autismo y discapacidades. Por ejemplo, muchas personas con autismo no se sienten contentas con Autism Speaks y la terapia ABA. Sin embargo, muchas de las personas neurotípicas no escuchan a las personas con autismo y continúan apoyándolos sin importar las diversas ocasiones en las cuales hemos expresado nuestra incomodidad. También he aprendido que la mayoría de las personas que abogan por los derechos de personas con autismo son caucásicas. Usualmente yo soy la única persona que no es caucásica en paneles de discusión. Me gustaría ver más personas que aboguen por los derechos de las personas con autismo que luzcan como yo y hablen español.
Sí, yo tengo una pregunta. I have a question. ¿Cómo ser Latinx influye? ¿Cómo el ser Latinx influye en tu trabajo de abogacía? How does being Latinx or Black influence your advocacy work?
So for me, it influences a lot. I'm not Latinx, I am Black. My parents are from West Africa. They're immigrants here. And so I think that part of that is why I wasn't identified as autistic growing up. I didn't make much eye contact, but in our culture, that's normal. The way that I spoke was different, but in a multilingual household, that's normal too. So my family just accommodated me, and it wasn't, I knew that I was different, but I didn't know what it was. With my children, I've noticed that, you know, when I go to a lot of events related to autism, often there are very few families that look like me. There's, as Kayla mentioned, there's mostly white families. There aren't, people aren't discussing issues that are of importance to those of us who, you know, are from immigrant backgrounds and have different cultures. So these are things that I try to point out and bring up the fact that intersectionality is important, that it's not just the diagnosis of autism, but it's also race and culture. All these things also affect people.
Okay, so Jasmine is going to finish her notes. And what I do want to say, while she's getting that done, is that I'm going to be commenting after she translates for you, because you did say a couple things in there that I want to explain to our audience as to the reason why La Hora del Cafecito relates to that.
Yo no soy Latinx, soy de la raza negra, soy de África o descendiente de padres de africanos. Cuando estaba creciendo no recibí un diagnóstico como autismo, a pesar de que había ciertas características, por ejemplo, falta de contacto visual, pero eso es parte de la cultura, de nuestra cultura. También cierta dificultad en el lenguaje, pero como era un hogar con lenguajes múltiples, pues también era cierto tipo, hasta cierto punto normal. Y mi familia pensó que era normal y hicieron las acomodaciones necesarias. Ahora, en relación con mis hijos, pues, por ejemplo, compartir era un poquito difícil encontrar personas y familias, ¿no? Como yo, como nosotros, muchas familias o comunidades hispanas. Y es algo de lo que yo he estado trabajando es para hacer, para incorporar, ¿no? La importancia de las diferentes culturas, las diferentes razas y cómo eso afecta a las demás personas.
Muy bien. Thank you so much for that comment. So there were a couple of things that I picked up while you were talking about. And both of you talked about wanting people who look like you. And so that tells me that, and you brought out the point, the reason why we have La Hora del Cafecito as a show is precisely to start moving that conversation forward, to start getting our community, Hispanic community, Latinx community, informed about issues that affect autism and how to get involved. You brought up the point that there's not very many people like you in the community, and coincidentally, that is precisely the point that for what we brought you here. We want people in the community to realize the importance and the impact that self-advocacy and advocacy for our own groups can have in moving the conversation forward, in moving the resources to be available for us and the information about autism and what is autism, right? Because Morenike, you were diagnosed as an adult, right? While your children were getting diagnosed, right? And the same thing happened for Maggie and with her oldest son. He didn't get diagnosed until she was getting a diagnosis for the younger one. And so it became so obvious that through the questioning, like, no, that's not him, that's my oldest. No, that's not him, that's my oldest. And through that, it was like, wait a second. And the evaluators say, maybe we need to have in your case, Morenike, have you be tested? And in the case of Maggie's, or evaluated, and in the case of Maggie, have her son be diagnosed, right? So now I'm gonna translate into Spanish what I just said. La importancia de esta conversación que estamos teniendo hoy en día, precisamente, es por eso que los traímos. Las dos hablaron de que en su experiencia no hay mucha gente en la mesa que se parecen a ellas, ¿no? Que tienen ese aspecto de los latinos, de la raza negra, en la cual están siendo representados. Entonces yo comenté que por eso es el propósito de la Hora del Cafecito, traerles a ustedes información sobre el autismo que nos impacta a nosotros como comunidad. Y hoy mismo tenemos a dos personas que son autoabogan por ellas y por sus familiares y por su propia raza individualmente. Y eso es lo que queríamos dejarles saber, que ustedes también se pueden envolver. Ustedes también pueden ser parte de esta conversación y empezar a abogar por sí mismos o por sus familiares, ¿okay? Así que gracias por la oportunidad, Morenike, thank you for being here. Thank you, Kayla, for being here and giving us this opportunity to bring this information about the advocacy to our community. But I don't want to hold it, so let's keep going, okay? Gracias por estar aquí y por darnos la oportunidad de traer información sobre abogacía a nuestra audiencia. Pero continuemos. Inma?
No, Kayla.
Ah, Kayla, sola. Sorry, Kayla, go ahead and answer how does being Latinx influence your advocacy work?
I feel the need to represent the Latinx community as well as the autistic community. Like I said, I rarely see any Latinx autistics, so I feel that I must make sure that we are represented. Autism can be a part of anyone, including Latinx people, and I want people to know that. I also want to educate people about autism, especially the Latinx people, because I feel Latinx people in general do not know a lot about autism due to lack of financial resources, lack of understanding of autism, and autistics that are undiagnosed or diagnosed later in life.
Siento la necesidad de representar tanto a la comunidad latina como a la comunidad autista. Como dije, rara vez veo a personas latinas autistas, así que siento que debo asegurarme de que estemos representados. El autismo puede ser parte de cualquier persona, incluidas las personas latinas, y quiero que la gente lo sepa. También quiero educar a las personas sobre el autismo, especialmente a las personas Latinx, porque siento que las personas Latinx o Latinx en general no saben mucho sobre el autismo debido a la falta de recursos financieros, la falta de comprensión acerca del tema del autismo, los autistas que no se diagnostican o se diagnostican tarde o más adelante en la vida.
Bien. Bueno, y tú que nos estás viendo, ¿qué preguntas te gustaría hacerle a nuestro panel? Déjanos saber ahí abajo en los comentarios. Nosotras trataremos de responder a sus preguntas y comentarios mientras estamos en el aire. I want to remind our viewers and invite you to leave us some comments and questions. We will be monitoring your comments and questions, and we try to respond to them while we're still on the air. What questions do you want to ask the panel? Do we have any questions now? Jasmine, ¿tenemos algo?
Oh, perdóname. No tenemos preguntas, pero tenemos a Mayra Collazo, que nos dice, good morning and many blessings to all. Thank you, Mayra, for being here with us today. Muchas gracias, Mayra, por estar aquí con nosotros and blessings for you too. Tenemos a Jennifer Ace, que nos manda saludos. Thank you, Jennifer, for being here with us. And tenemos a Christine Rover. Thank you, Christine, for being here with us this morning. She said good morning to this wonderful group. So muchas gracias, Christine, por estar aquí con nosotros y por tu mensaje.
Perfecto, muchas bien. Y creo que teníamos que dejarles saber que nos dejen preguntas antes de que salgamos del aire. The Morenike is going to be talking about her her book, and then we got a surprise. So be sure to leave your messages, okay? All righty, there we go. Okay, Olivia.
¿Cómo conectas con tu identidad Latinx o negra? So how do you connect your Latinx or Black identity?
For me, it's a very important part of who I am. However, because of being autistic, I feel that it's different for me than it is other people in my culture. I love my culture, but there's certain things about it that are challenging for me because I'm autistic. So we are, you know, very like multi-generational. So, you know, there's aunties and uncles and grandma and grandpa and all these people together, and, you know, festive get-togethers that are loud and lots of food and music and people loving on each other and people wanting to hug and kiss. And it can be a lot when you're autistic to have to deal with that. Mm-hmm. Also, there's certain things that are considered respectful behavior. And so if you don't do those things, like with my children, people might not understand that it's because of autism and think that your child is being rude. So those are some things that are part of it. I try to tell my children to be very proud of who they are, of their race, of their culture, of being American, of being African, of being autistic.
Mm-hmm. You're describing is so interesting how you know, your culture and our culture as Hispanics are so, so similar. As I'm hearing you talk, it's like, yep, that's us too. Just the same. And it's funny because we have a lot, I mean, at least in Puerto Rico, we have a lot of the African culture, like food, music, rituals, religions, and a lot of influence.
ISIS.
Yes, yes. Actually, my great-grandfather, he was African, you know, so it's not that far from, you know, it's not a very long generation. So it is interesting. I'm laughing because it's like, yep, that's us. So lo que estoy diciendo es que me estaba riendo mientras Morenike estaba explicando su respuesta y su cultura, porque definitivamente van a ver que nosotros como hispanos tenemos muchas similitudes, ¿no? A la cultura de ella, a la cultura africana. Pero esto es lo que ella nos explicó. Ella nos dice que parte importante de quién es ella, como ella es parte de obviamente, de la cultura y de donde ella es. Sin embargo, es un poquito diferente porque, voy a cambiar a primera persona, porque soy autista y nosotros somos, como cultura, somos multigeneracionales. Por ejemplo, la familia, los abrazos, los besos, hablamos bien alto, todo eso, ¿no? Pues eso crea cierta, a veces, cierta incomodidad, ¿no? Hacia las personas que tenemos autismo. Por ejemplo, en relación a mis hijos, a veces ellos pueden hacer algo o no hacer algo, ¿no? Que se espera que ellos hagan algo y no lo hacen esperado por parte de la cultura, y se puede considerar como de que son un poquito irrespetuosos por no hacer lo que es esperado o por hacer algo que para ellos, entonces, como la cultura de nosotros, pues es algo de ser irrespetuoso.
And that is definitely true because, for example, the expectation of having maybe family members have an expectation that our children should be hugging and kissing on aunties and uncles and all that stuff. The spices, we talked about the food having lots of spices. And for someone with autism who may have that olfactory sensitivities, it can be very overwhelming. The sounds also, that sensory the sensitivities that are, you know, very often part of the autism diagnosis. And so it can be very challenging. Estaba diciendo que es verdad que a veces nuestros familiares, como dijo Jasmine, en nuestra propia cultura hispana, que nosotros esperamos que ay, darle un abrazo y un beso a todas las tías, a todos los primos, eso es, todo el tiempo estamos saludándonos de abrazo y beso. Cuando una persona con autismo, pues a lo mejor tiene sensitividades como olfactorias, también la comida alrededor, los perfumes, los abrazos, a lo mejor una sensitividad de tacto, que no quieren que los toquen, que no quieren. Entonces estamos en una expectativa de que, ay, tu hijo que es antipático, que no saluda, no es, es como lo esperamos. Y eso es lo que nos estaba diciendo Morenike, y Jasmine también. Así que muy buen punto. Pero continuemos con Kayla. Kayla, how about you? How do you connect your Latinx identity?
Even though it is a part of me that I wouldn't want to deny or hide, to be honest, I'm not well-versed in my Latinx/Puerto Rican identity and culture. I do not natively speak Spanish, and while I am trying to learn it, it is quite difficult for me to learn a language. I don't like most Puerto Rican foods because I am a picky eater, and I don't like most Spanish songs, except for reggaeton. Sometimes I'm not really Latinx because I'm not immersed in its culture. However, that couldn't be farther from the truth. Being Latinx is and always will be a part of me. Just because I'm not in the Latinx culture doesn't mean I'm not Latinx. When I see other Latinx people around me, I feel comfort.
Yeah, very good.
Aunque es parte de mí, la cual nunca escondería ni negaría, para ser honesta, no estoy muy familiarizada con la identidad y cultura Latinx puertorriqueña. No hablo español y a pesar que estoy tratando de aprender, se me hace difícil el aprender un nuevo idioma. No me gusta la mayoría de la comida puertorriqueña, ya que soy bien selectiva en los alimentos que consumo, sea picky, ¿no? No me gusta la mayoría de las canciones hispanas, excepto reggaetón. A veces siento que no soy realmente Latinx porque no siento ese interés en la cultura. Sin embargo, el ser Latinx es siempre y será parte de mí. No porque no estoy inmersa en la cultura Latinx, no significa que no soy Latinx. Me siento cómoda cuando estoy alrededor de personas latinas o Latinx.
Y antes que estábamos en de empezar, before we got started, we were talking about the fact that, you know, those of us who were born and raised in our countries have a different culture than our own children who were born and raised here in the United States. So I totally identify with what you're saying, Kayla, because my own children feel more American than they feel Puerto Rican. Nonetheless, the Puerto Rican upbringing that I was able to impart on them did influence their upbringing. Therefore, they're not totally American, so to speak, because they have that Puerto Rican food, the Puerto Rican tendencies, the loudness, whatever it is that I brought into the picture. So, le estaba diciendo que yo me identifico con lo que dice, porque yo que me crié en Puerto Rico, y crié a mis hijos que nacieron y vivieron aquí. La cultura de ellos, aunque fue influenciada por la mía, no es totalmente puertorriqueña tampoco. Y más bien ellos se identifican como americanos, ¿verdad? Y más bien ellos hablan inglés, aunque entienden todo el español y hasta lo hablan. Pero como dice Keila, no por eso no son puertorriqueños, no por eso no son latinos, ¿entiendes? Entonces, estoy de acuerdo con lo que ella dijo. Muy bien.
Can I say something, even though I know we were asking questions, but I just thought of something.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I'm remembering the very first time that my children's great-grandmother came to the U.S. to see them. And one of my daughters is named, her middle name is, you know, after her great-grandmother. And so they've, you know, there's been FaceTime and all these things, but the first time she met the children in person, she doesn't speak any English, you know, so she flew here and she came to the house and she wrapped her arms around my daughter and she kissed her, and my daughter like scrunched up her face and like wiped her face, the thing off. And you could just see her great grandmother's face just crumble because she didn't understand. It was just awful. You know, it was autism. It wasn't about rejecting her, but it was just things like that, that you don't know how to explain to people.
Yes, yes. And Jasmine is taking her notes, but that is so realistic, right? And that would also be associated with small children. You can't control that, what happens, right? You can't control how they react. They're very honest, and they're very in that would be all. We were talking about the sensitivities, maybe that tactile sensitivity, the smell, and having to explain that to people who don't know about autism and are not aware of it. They might take it personal.
Recuerdo la primera vez que la bisabuela de los nenes vino a ver a mis hijos, si habían tenido contacto a través de video, ¿no? De charlas de video, pero nunca presencial, era la primera vez. Ella no habla inglés y cuando llegó le dio un beso y un abrazo y apapachó a mi niña, a mi hija. Y la nena pues se limpió el donde le dieron el beso, y estaba como que haciendo caritas y como que déjame en paz, no porque ella estaba rechazando a su abuelita, sino porque es parte de ser autista, es parte de tener el diagnóstico de autismo.
Mm-hmm. Well, can I share something real quick?
Yeah.
I just want to say, like, I have family in Puerto Rico. Both my mom and my dad are from Puerto Rico, and I also feel like sometimes they don't understand me, even though I love them, but I don't think they understand me. I want to learn Spanish too, like, because most of them, they mostly speak Spanish, so I want to learn Spanish to communicate with them, but even then I still don't feel like they'll understand me because of me, they don't understand autism, so yeah.
Y esta es la razón, this is the reason for the show. This is for the reason por la hora del cafecito. Es explicarle a nuestra comunidad, explicarle a nuestra padres y familiares y personas que están relacionadas de alguna manera, ya sea por amistad o porque proveen servicios o porque son amigos de individuos con autismo, es explicarles a ellos cuáles son algunas de las características, cómo debemos trabajar el por qué, y hacer de esta conversación algo que informe a la comunidad para que haya más aceptación y haya más inclusión en nuestra comunidad. So I was just saying that this is the reason why La Hora del Cafecito was created. It's to bring information to the community, to everyone who, the family members, as well as those who support individuals and caregivers who support individuals in our community who may be living with autism. So it's just a way of sharing information in order to make our community more inclusive and more aware of the diverse needs of others. Okay, so thank you very much for sharing that, Keila. Maggie?
Lourdes.
Thank you. I'm having a hard time like not jumping in, and because I'm making so many connections with Morenike and with Keila, and you know, all of these, you know, I have flashbacks of, you know, events with my kids. So thank you. I have
wait. Like Yasmin hasn't translated for Kayla.
Yes.
Sorry.
Thank you, Olivia.
She keeps us honest. This is Olivia's job.
Voy ahora a traducir por Kayla. Voy a ser primera persona. Tengo mucha familia en Puerto Rico. Mi mamá y mi papá ambos son también de Puerto Rico. Y a veces siento que ellos no me entienden. Ellos hablan mucho más el español. Yo estoy tratando de aprender el español, pero siento que no me entienden más bien como persona autista.
Okay. Ahora sí, Maggie.
So, I had a question. ¿Qué le dirían a los miembros de nuestra audiencia que nos están escuchando, que también son miembros de otros grupos de minorías para darles esperanza? What would you say to our audience who may be members of other minority groups to include the Latinx and Black community to give them hope?
I think that there are actually a lot of strengths in our different cultures that can be helpful in terms of, you know, your autistic child succeeding. Because I live in Houston, and so we have, it's a very diverse population. We have we're very close to Mexico. We have, a Black population. We have a lot of people from South Asia, so India. It's very mixed. And one thing that a lot of our cultures have is resilience. We're able to, to thrive in the midst of challenging circumstances. We're also accustomed to having one foot in one culture and one foot in another, whether it's customs, whether it's languages, holidays. We're used to having to change up and look at things from a different perspective. I think that can be helpful with raising an autistic child or being autistic. Another thing that I think that is there that's important is that usually there's a strong type of community connection, whether it's extended family, or friends or family of choice. There's usually love and support, even if people don't necessarily understand autism. That love and support is really important. And so I think that a lot of us, whether people are Asian or Latinx or Black, downplay the strengths that we have and feel intimidated by autism without realizing that we already possess a lot of the skills that will allow, for growth and, and a happy life.
While she's translating, I wanted to say the resilience, I connected with the resilience, having to be separated from family, sometimes from the home country. I was born here, but both my parents were immigrants as well. So, you have that living in different worlds and having that be part of your culture.
That is correct. And I can say that also like Maggie's saying, yeah, as Hispanics, we're very resilient, extremely resilient. And that's a strength that we also have. And yeah. Para traducir para Morenik, voy a traducir en primera persona, por supuesto. Pienso que hay mucha fortaleza en todas las culturas para que su hijo o su hija con autismo pueda tener éxito. Estoy viviendo en Texas, donde hay gran diversidad de cultura. Nuestra cultura es bien resiliente y nota aparte, nuestra cultura hispana también es bien resiliente. Significa que somos, que podemos, tenemos la capacidad de enfrentar las diferentes dificultades y retos que nos trae la vida y poder seguir hacia adelante. Es lo que significa ser resiliente. También es importante tener, a veces tenemos un pie en una cultura y otro pie en la otra cultura, ¿no? Sin embargo, para poder lidiar con esas dificultades, pues a veces es importante también cambiar un poquito las perspectivas en las cosas y tratar de unir, ¿no?, a ambas culturas, comprometerse, ¿no?, en las diferentes culturas. Para las familias extendidas, el amor, el apoyo de la familia es bien importante. Yo entiendo que como cultura tenemos las fortalezas para poder seguir creciendo y tener una vida feliz.
Thank you.
So Kayla, your turn. Kayla? So yeah, go ahead. How what would you say to our audience who maybe members of other minority groups to include the Latinx and Black community so that you can give them some hope?
I would say to the Latinx autistic that they are not alone, even though it feels like it. I get how it feels to not be represented or seen. I know what it's like to not know anyone like you. But know that's not the case and look online for resources to help you find other Latinx autistics like this. I would also say to accept who they are and that autism doesn't need to be cured, treated, or prevented. Also, make sure you advocate for what you need. To the parents, if you don't understand English, try to find resources online that aren't in Spanish or use Google Translate to translate into Spanish and try to find places to have a Spanish translator. ASAN and AWN are great resources to use. Please also accept your child for who they are because there's nothing wrong with them. Finally, I would say listen to their child because they are the expert of their own lives, meaning they know what's best for them. Support them in getting what they need and want to be successful in life.
I love it. I love it. Thank you so much. That was wonderful. Yes.
A las personas Latinx con autismo les digo que no están solos o solas. Yo puedo entender lo que se siente no ser representados o tomados en cuenta. También sé lo que se siente no conocer a nadie como tú. Pero quiero que sepas que ese no es el caso. Existen recursos en línea que te pueden ayudar a encontrar otras personas latinas, Latinx con autismo. Yo les diría que se acepten como son y que el autismo no necesita ser curado, tratado o prevenido. En adición, aboga también por tus necesidades. A los papás, si no comprenden el idioma inglés, traten de encontrar recursos en línea que sean en español o utilizar la traducción que provee el sistema Google para traducir de inglés a español. Traten también de encontrar lugares que ofrezcan traducción al español. Por ejemplo, ASAN y AWN son excelentes recursos a utilizar. Por favor, acepten a su hijo o a su hija por lo que son, ya que no hay nada incorrecto con ellos. Finalmente, escuchen a su hijo y a su hija, porque ellos son los expertos de su propia vida, lo que significa que ellos saben lo que es mejor para ellos mismos. Apóyenlos en obtener lo que necesitan para que puedan ser exitosos en la vida.
Qué mensaje tan bonito, así mismo es. Yeah, I really love it. A very, very uplifting message about acceptance and about the fact that there's nothing wrong, nothing to be fixed. It's like being blunt, you know, you're bored with it. And so why would you want to change it? So I like that message. So thank you for saying that. And hopefully that will sink in with our audience. And they, you know, they start seeing, and it's already, some people are already there. But for those who are just getting started, who may be thinking, you know, how can I fix this? You know, just know you don't have to fix it, right? You just have to accept it and find supports and just find ways to that meet your needs. So, gracias por ese mensaje tan bonito, porque la verdad que es muy alentador saber que como padres, sobre todo aquellos que están ya empezando este camino en el mundo del autismo, que no tienen que arreglar nada, acepten a sus hijos como son, como dijo Kayla, y sepan que verdaderamente es como nacer rubio, o sea, es algo que es lo que es, y que busquen la manera de facilitarle sus necesidades, más no el cambiarlo, sino acéptenlo como son. Me encanta ese mensaje de aceptación. Gracias a Kayla por compartirlo. Bueno, y algo más que quieren compartir. Is there anything else you want to share with our audience? You can, you know.
Yes, and so I wanted to share, there is a book, and Kayla is actually one of the authors in this book as well. Yes, thank you, Kayla. See, we have great minds think alike. The lighting is not good, but I'm trying to show the book. And it's called Sincerely Your Autistic Child. And it is available in audio version, e-version, and paperback. The book is also going to be translated into different languages by our publisher has contracted with someone. I don't know if they have those ones printed yet, but it's a book written by, there's 28 different people who are all autistic. And then there's two parents who wrote a foreword and a conclusion. In addition to Kayla, there's a few other Latinx authors. Mallory Cruz is one, Victoria Roldon is one. And I believe there's one of the anonymous authors is also. And then there's also authors who are white, Black, you know, multiracial. And we're sharing what ideas or things that we went through and giving advice and hope and encouragement to parents. Because we believe that although yes, there are some bad parents out there, most parents do care about their children. They do love them and they want them to thrive. And you can get some advice from professionals, but like Kayla said, your child knows who they are. We know best what we need. And so we want to just advise people to, you know, you can find the book. It's $16, $16 for the paperback. I think it's right now on sale for $14.70. The ebook is a little cheaper. I believe it's $12.99. And the audio, I think, is $24. We're also trying to get it into different libraries. It's in some libraries now, so that people will be able to check it out. It's just really important for people to hear our perspectives and you know, understand, you know, that, you know, their child is not broken, as Kayla said. The child is exactly who they're supposed to be.
Yes. Yes. Awesome. And I went ahead. Is that available on your website also?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
And there's one more resource, but I'll tell it after. There's a website that I'll put in the chat. It's a list of books in general about autism and neurodiversity. There's 6 books that are in Spanish on this one list from Not an Autism Mom. I'll put that in the chat.
Yes. And I also put in the link to your website on the chat, Desmond, so you can share. So awesome. So go ahead with translation.
Okay. Sí, hay un libro y donde Kayla es also también autora y Morenik es también autora del libro. Se llama Sincerely Your Autistic Child. También va a estar traducido en diferentes idiomas. Es compuesto por 28 personas con autismo y también padres de personas con autismo. Tenemos varios autores multiraciales que proveen sus experiencias y básicamente es tratar de enviar esperanza, apoyo a todos esos padres que obviamente la mayoría de los padres quieren lo mejor para sus hijos. Sí hay algunos padres que pues no son los mejores padres, pero la mayoría quieren lo mejor para sus niños. Y es, como dijo Kayla, que nosotros como personas con autismo sabemos mejor lo que nosotros necesitamos. Es comprender, para que los padres puedan comprender que su hijo o su hija no está roto, que ellos son quienes son y son como ellos deben de ser. La información acerca del libro que también puede, creo que va a estar también disponible en algunas bibliotecas y también es, el libro se encuentra en forma digital. Toda esa información la vamos a poner luego más tarde en los comentarios al final del programa.
Go ahead.
No, Christine nos dice que el libro electrónico ya se encuentra disponible en la biblioteca virtual de CARD.
Y Umi está preguntando el nombre. El nombre se llama Sinceramente Tu Hijo Autista en español. Sincerely Your Autistic Child. Yeah, Umi was asking the name. So es como quien dice una carta escrita por un hijo a un padre. It's like, by the title, we can tell that it's a letter written from an autistic child to a parent, so to speak. So it's things that if your child or your loved one with autism could tell you, they would tell you these things. And it's from the perspective of those who are autistic, who are living with autism in their lives. And so, you know, they're the experts, like Kayla said, they're experts on themselves. So awesome. So thank you so much. Me encanta que ya lo tenemos en nuestra biblioteca de e-library, cards e-library, and parents can access it through our e-library. If you're not, you haven't signed up for cards e-library, maybe we can put that link also there so people can go ahead and sign up and maybe access some of the books that we have available. So thank you so much. Oh my God, this has been a wonderful, wonderful.
Lourdes, you need to translate that part.
You see what I mean? See what? That's what we got, Lourdes. Ella es buenísima para decirnos cuando se me olvida traducir, porque es que uno a veces se le olvida hacer el switch. Okay, lo que le quería decir era que este, el libro es, si usted no es miembro ya de nuestra biblioteca electrónica de CARD, Jasmine le va a poner el link para que se haga miembro. Ese libro ya está escrito ahí. Está incluido. También tenemos otros libros que puede accesar. Y como ya dije, es un libro escrito como si fuera de su hijo o de su familiar querido con autismo a usted. Escrito por usted. Sinceramente, tu hijo autista se llama, es el título. ¿Qué quiere decir? Que es una, si te pudieran decir lo que ellos están pensando, lo que ellos quieren, ellos te lo están diciendo, pero viene desde la perspectiva de muchas personas, de muchos individuos que están viviendo con autismo, que tienen una opinión acerca de cosas que ellos hubiesen querido que los demás supieran sobre el autismo. Así que muchas gracias. Bueno, y queremos darle las gracias a nuestras invitadas del día de hoy, a Morenike y a Kayla. Thank you for being here today. We really appreciate you accepting our invitation to be on the show. It's been a wonderful experience, so I hope you enjoyed it as well. Gracias por haber estado aquí. Te lo agradecemos un montón. Okay. Bueno, no quería que nos fuéramos sin antes dejarles saber que la semana que viene vamos a estar entrevistando a una joven artista, Rainbow Motion, quien viene con su mamá, Yadira, hablando sobre su expresión artística y cómo la han impactado en todas las áreas de su vida y también cómo el autismo impacta su arte y su vida. Así que no se lo pueden perder. Rainbow Motion es una artista, pintora, es una abogada, self-advocate, que ella con su mamá, they travel a lot. Jasmine puso el artículo reciente que salió en un magazine de discapacidades en la que están hablando de ella, así que estamos muy emocionados de traerlo la semana que viene. Next week we're going to be interviewing Rainbow Mosho and her mother. Rainbow is an artist who's also a young artist who's written books. She's an author as well. And she's also a personality. She's been in articles. She's been she's got her own YouTube channel and all that stuff, conversations with her mom. So she's going to be telling us about her own experience with autism as an artist and how autism has impacted her life as well as her art. Así que I hope that you can join us. And you'll be here. It's also going to be a bilingual show, but we hope to see you there. Okay. So thank you again to Morenike and to Kayla for being here. I hope Morenike is going to have also at the end of this month, there's going to be a town hall. If you want to hear more about this, CARD is bringing you another town hall. There's going to be information to follow on our Facebook page about her town hall. Talk that she's going to have with us, so you can't miss it, all right? Bueno, y como todos los viernes, les quiero pedir un favorcito y es que entren en el link que le vamos a dejar ahí abajo para que se evalúen. Dejen saber si ustedes encuentran valor en lo que estamos haciendo. I want to ask you a small favor. Would you please click on the link that we will post under the video so that you can give us a rating? It's a survey, 16 seconds, very quick. If you've done it before, we need you to do it one more time. Every time we go in the air, we need you to please click on that link and just, you know, give us your comments about how we're doing. This is the way we can justify the time that it takes us to come on the air and just be on the air with you. So we hope that you can do that. Bueno, y como todos los viernes, no olviden darnos un me gusta y compartir nuestra página de grupo Hard Español con sus amistades y con todos aquellos que ustedes crean se pueden beneficiar de este programa, ¿ok? Y sobre todo, recuerden reservar en sus calendarios todos los viernes a las 10 de la mañana, ¿ok? Don't forget to give us a like, share our page and this video with your friends and those you know who could benefit from this. And remember to save Fridays at 10 a.m. to be here next week. For sure, it's going to be a bilingual show, so I hope you can join us. And but before we go, is there anything else anybody wants to say before we go? We hope? No? Okay, pues ya saben que con café y con dulzura, los problemas se curan. Que Dios me los bendiga. Nos vemos la semana que viene. Chao, chao. We'll see you next week.